Okay, thanks a lot for inviting me to give this lecture. So let me first apologize for the fact that my English sounds a lot like French. And so I hope you will still be able to understand what I have to say. Well, I was reassured to see that your French sounds a lot like English, but at least you don't try to lecture in French. So that's... So I'm very glad to be here to talk to you about inequality and capital in the 21st century. So let me say that, you know, these lectures, so today and tomorrow morning, are partly based upon my book, Capital in the 21st Century, but is also will also be based on more recent research. Let me make very clear that this research comes from a very collective research program, and there is no way, you know, I could be here today and I could have written this book without the help of many co-authors with whom we have been collecting this historical database on income and wealth. In particular, I am very fortunate to have worked for a long time with Tony Atkinson, who disappeared on January 1st of this year, who spent some of his early career in Cambridge and wrote major works in Cambridge. And, you know, Tony Atkinson, in a way, together with Simon Kuznets in the 1950s, Tony Atkinson is really the sort of the godfather of all modern historical work on inequality and income and wealth inequality. And, you know, there is no way I could have done this without Tony. So I really wanted to start by saying this. I first started working on the history of income distribution in France 15 years ago. Tony was my first reader. You know, this was a time when economists, at least British economists, were able to read French, so he read my work in French, and you know, we started working together and we collected data for several dozen countries. And so if you know, today I'm going to present some of this data, but of course there is no way, you know, now we have more than 100 academics from over 70 countries all around the world who have joined this process of historical data collection on income and wealth, so there is no way I could present all the series today. So if you want to have a better sense of what we have been doing, you can look online on this website where a lot of the data has been published. So, you know, at least you will have a better sense of what there is in my book and what there is in this database. So, you know, this was actually the initial website that we created with Tony Atkinson and Facundo Alvaredo. The countries in red, like Britain or France or the US, were already in the database at the time I wrote this book, and the countries in blue, like Russia or Brazil, are currently being added to the database. We also moved to a new website in January, which looks a lot nicer, where you can draw maps of inequality all around the world. So, you know, if you want to know more about what we are doing and all the countries that are currently under study, please have a look at this. In these lectures, I'm going to try to make four points. Well, the first two will be today, and the last two will be tomorrow. So let me describe them very, very quickly. So the first point will be about the long-run dynamics of income inequality, and I will sort of summarize some of the lessons from my book and also present some new material. Probably the most important lesson in the first point is that if we want to understand the long-run reduction in income inequality during the 20th century, one of the main lessons is that it took very big shocks, in particular wars, the Great Depression, revolution to some extent, for the reduction in inequality to happen, partly through sheer destruction of wealth and capital stock, but most importantly and more positively through a change in the policy regime and institutions, which to a large extent were refused by the elite until you know, before these shocks happened, in particular until World War I, and which were put in place gradually after World War I and most importantly after World War II. The second point will be more about wealth than about income, and I will talk about the possibility of a return in recent decades and in the future of a sort of what I call a patrimonial or wealth-based society in the book, and the possibility that with high return to wealth, in particular for large wealth portfolio, and low growth rate, and therefore a high gap between the rate of return and the growth rate in the coming decades, wealth inequality might rise again, and I will stress the need for more democratic transparency on wealth. Then point number three will be about inequality in emerging countries and the post-colonial world. One of the main limitations of my book, there are many limitations in my book, you know, this is really ongoing work, but probably one of the main limitations is that it's a little bit too Western-centered. And this is not entirely my fault. This is also that the accessibility to historical data sources for outside Western countries was more difficult. One of the most positive impact of the success of my book was to open access to more data in more countries. So there is a number of countries like Brazil or to some extent China, India, Russia, Mexico, Korea, on which we didn't have as much access to the data before the book was published. And the success of the book contributed to put pressure on government and you know, journalists asking government, you know, why is Brazil not in the database? And finally, we were able to obtain access to fiscal data and in some cases fiscal archives. And so I will present some of the new results, in particular about what I call here extreme inequality regime, with levels of inequality in the Middle East, in Brazil, in South Africa, higher than what we observe in the West. And I will stress the need to go beyond the Western perspective on inequality. So my book is, you know, puts a lot of importance on the shocks that happened in particular in Europe through World War I, World War II, which of course are very important for the history of Europe and for the history of inequality in Europe. But from the perspective of South Africa or Brazil or India, you know, it's not that these shocks are not important, but they are not as important. And if we take a longer run perspective on inequality regimes, we give certainly less importance to this shock and to this European historical dynamics than what I do in my book. So this is, I think, one additional reason why we need to go beyond this Western perspective on inequality. And finally, the last point will be about the link between rising inequality and the, you know, the rise of populism and in particular nationalist political forces. And I guess, you know, the big question here is, given that you have rising inequality and rising concentration of income and wealth, you could expect that there should be, you know, rising political demand for redistribution and, in a way, rising demand for some form of class-based politics and vertical redistribution between income and wealth classes. And what we seem to be observing to some extent is a little bit the opposite, in the sense that you have less class-based politics and more identity-based or political conflict based on ethnic identity or national identity. And so the big question is, you know, why do we seem to see that? And is it possible to relate rising inequality with this changing structure of political conflict? So, of course, you know, I wish I had a perfect answer to these questions, which, of course, I don't have, but at least I will try to present to you a number of results and thoughts about this issue. And so this will be tomorrow morning, and in particular, I will show you some results about the structure, the changing structure of the electorate in the context of the French elections that we've just seen for the first round, as compared to the structure of the electorate in recent decades, and how this has been changing, in particular regarding who's voting for the right, who's voting for the left. Well, to the extent that these words, of course, have the same meaning today, which they used to, which is, of course, not clear at all. So this is, you know, this will be the general framework that I will try to follow. So, you know, this looks very organized. You know, I don't know how organized it will be in practice, but, you know, in principle, this is what I plan to follow. So we should stop today at the end of point two and start tomorrow at the beginning of point three. Okay, so let me start directly with point one. So what have we learned? If we look at our database on income inequality, what have we learned about, you know, the long-run dynamics of income inequality? So as I already said, probably the most important finding is what I I refer here as the end of the Kuznets curve, the end of universal law. So to understand what I mean, I should first remind you, you know, for, you know, I'm sure many of you know this, but that the first economist to start collecting historical data on income distribution was Simon Kuznets. So Simon Kuznets was an American economist, Ukrainian-born, who became American in the interwar period. He was the first economist to compute national accounts for the US. So the first series of national income GDP for the US were computed by Simon Kuznets in the interwar period. And then his next task right after World War II was to use, together with the new national income series he had estimated for the US, to use the data coming from the income tax in the US, which had been created in 1913, so the federal income tax in the US was created in 1913, and to use this data in order to compute the share of national income going to the different income groups, in particular to the top 10% income group, and to look at the evolution of the share going to the top 10% between 1913 and 1948. Okay? And he published his work in 1953. Now, he had only one country over a 35-year period, but this was much more than what we had before. Okay? So in the 19th century, you know, or in the early 20th century, at the time of Alfred Marshall, or you know, at the time of, you know, in the 19th century, at the time of Ricardo or Marx or other 19th century economists, people, of course, were talking about income distribution all the time, but they didn't have data, or they didn't have historical series on income distribution, which, you know, puts limit on what you can say, or actually sometimes it puts no limit on what you can say, which is, you know, which is even more problematic. So Kuznets was the first economist to have something. So he had only one country over 35 years, but this was a big progress. And most importantly, he came with a very good news, which was a reduction of inequality. So let me actually show you the graph. So except that, so Kuznets stopped in the 1950s. So all what we've done with Emmanuel Saez in order to compute this is to redo the computation of Kuznets, except that we were able to add another half century. So Kuznets stopped in 1948 and we have another half century. And also we've added 30 more countries. Okay, so all what we've been doing is we have been pursuing the work of Kuznets, but to a much broader scale with many more years and many more countries. And of course this changes quite a bit the conclusion, because Kuznets writing in the 1950s came with a very positive conclusion, which was a reduction of inequality. Whereas when you look at the later period, you can see that you know, at the end of the period, we are back to the inequality at the beginning or even higher. So this changes quite a lot the interpretation. So in fact, if you read Kuznets in the 1950s, he was very much aware of the fact that the reduction of inequality that happened in the US between 1913 and 1948 had a lot to do with World War II, the Great Depression, and that there was nothing particularly natural in this evolution. Well, you know, there's never anything natural in economic evolution. It always depends on the legal system, on institutions. You know, there's nothing natural in economic forces. But at that time, it was particularly unnatural. You know, you have the Great Depression, you have World War II, you have very major events. And Kuznets himself was very much aware that these events played a role. But then, you know, if you read, you know, his famous 1955 article, which was his speech to the American Economic Association, of which he was the president, you know, he starts by describing all these unusual shocks that caused the reduction of inequality. And then at the end of the article, he says, well, maybe there could have been some other mechanism which would lead to what was then, which will later be known as the Kuznets curve, which will be the idea that actually there can be some sort of spontaneous reason why you have a reduction of inequality in the advanced stages of development. For instance, there is the famous Kuznets two-sector model where, you know, initially you move from a low productivity sector. Some people move from a low productivity sector to a high productivity sector, so inequality increases, and then in the long run, everybody will go to the high productivity sector, so inequality will naturally decline. But this theory of the Kuznets, this sort of very optimistic view that, you know, in the long run, everybody, you know, inequality will decline and growth will benefit everybody. Kuznets himself did not believe too much into this optimistic Kuznets curve story, but in the Cold War context of the 50s, 60s, 70s, this was kind of happy and that everybody was, or at least many people, in particular in the West, were happy to believe. You know, it was a very strong political message to send, in particular, to all the newly independent countries who were tempted by communism and the Soviet bloc. You know, it was a very powerful message to say, well, look, you know, be patient. You know, don't make mistakes. You know, don't. You should just wait, and at some point, you will have also a growth and reduction of inequality. And you know, so there was, you know, this has always been, you know, inequality has always been a very, you know, political issue, and certainly the lack of research in this area for a long time has been a strong limitation for on the quality of the debate. So why is it that the work of Kuznets was not pursued until recently? You know, I think this is due to a large extent to rigid boundaries between the social sciences. So in a way, you know, using this historical tax data was something that was viewed as too historical for economists and too economic for historians, so that in the end, nobody was really doing it. Also, to be honest, you know, what we've done with Atkinson, Saez, and all this group of researchers to collect this historical data is a lot easier to do today with the modern information technologies than when, you know, at the time of Kuznets, where people were doing it almost everything by hand. So you know, it's you know, we are not particularly heroic. You know, it's just modern information technologies make our work a lot easier. So anyway, what do we learn from this? So let me describe what you have on this graph. So this is a simple indicator of inequality, which is the share of total income going to the top 10%. So if we had complete equality, it should be 10%. Okay, the top 10% should have 10% of total income. So you never have complete equality. If it was complete inequality, it should be 100%. Now in practice, it's typically between 30 and 50% for income. For wealth inequality, so for the inequality of property, it's much more than this. The share going to the top 10% can be typically between 50 and 90%. So just to get the orders of magnitude, for income, it could be more between 30 and 50, or even, as we will see tomorrow, in very high inequality country like South Africa or Brazil, it can go to 60% of total income for the top 10. But you never get to 90% like for wealth, you know, except in extreme slave societies where, you know, 80% of the population is in slavery, which you see sometimes in history. But in sort of normal societies, the maximum level of income inequality will be, say, 60% of total income for the top 10. Now, in the case of the US, you go from 50 to 30, back to 50. So these are big variations. Okay, these are very large variations. You can see that the period of the 50s, 60s, 70s, where you have stable inequality at a relatively low level by historical standards, this is like the ideal of post-World War II balanced growth, in a way. So this means, you know, when you have a stable share for the top 10%, it means that everybody benefits from growth at the same speed. So it means that, you know, in 1960 or 1970, if you have 3% GDP growth per capita, you know, everybody grows at 3%. The average income of the top 10 goes up at 3%. The average income of the bottom 90 goes up at 3%. So this is what a stable share means. So you have inequality, you have some poor people, some rich people, but everybody goes up at the same speed. So in a way, you don't care too much about inequality. The sense that everybody. Now, in the recent period, well, what I mean by the recent period, the period starting around 1980, after the election of Ronald Reagan, you don't have balanced growth at all. Okay, when you go from 30 to 50% in 3 decades, you know, it means that basically, I will show you later, this means that there was essentially no growth for the bottom 50% of the population, and most of the growth was taken by the top of the distribution, so this is quite spectacular. So you can see that part of the fluctuation has to do with capital gains. You know, so typically it's you know, before 2007 you can make big capital gains, or before the stock market crash of 2000 you can make big capital gains, and after the crash you it's not a good time to make big capital gains. But what's important is that in the end there's a long-term evolution, which is also true without taking into account at all the stock market effect of the capital gains, and which you know, seems to recover after the crisis. And so the last data point that we are here in 2012 is higher than before the crisis, and it's also higher than 1929, which was the previous high point. Okay. So looking at this graph, Many people in the US feel that rising inequality, it's not only that it means very limited growth for the bottom half of the population, as we will see, but many people feel that probably rising inequality has also contributed to a rising household debt for the bottom half of the population in order to try to compensate for the stagnation of their income. And in the end, probably has also contributed to the fragility, the growing fragility of the financial system, which has led to the 2008 crash. So here we are talking about really very big, very large transfer of income, which in effect are going to put large pressure on the financial system in order to compensate through lending and borrowing some of this income shift. Now, how can we explain the rising inequality of the recent decades? Well, the first thing, before we go for explanation, the first thing is to see, do we observe the same evolution everywhere, or is it particularly strong in the US? And so I'm going to show you a couple of graphs. On Europe and Japan and comparing with the US, in this presentation, sometime I will show you some annual series so that you can see the shocks and the short-run fluctuations, which are an important part of the story. And sometime, and in particular in the next graph, I will show you decennial averages so that you can focus on long-run evolution. So if you look at decennial averages for the US, so this is the same evolution as before for the US. So this is Europe. So Europe, as you know, is a complicated continent. So what I call Europe here is the GDP weighted average between Britain, France, Germany, Italy, and Sweden. So it's not exactly Europe, but it's more Western Europe, to be honest. And you have differences in the different evolution. So the rising inequality is a bit stronger in Britain than in France and Germany in the recent period. But somehow the European countries are relatively close to one another. And to simplify, I just look at the European average. And you can see that you have rising inequality in Europe in the recent decades, but it is much less strong than in the US. So it doesn't mean that it did not happen, especially at a time where you have very low growth and a growth slowdown as compared to the 50s, 60s, 70s. The fact that the top 10% group took more than its share in aggregate growth, is something that can be upsetting for many people. But the truth is that it has been less spectacular than in the US. If we look at Japan, which is the third component of the rich world, you can see that it's sort of intermediate between Europe and the US, and to a large extent closer to Europe. So how do we explain the fact that you have rising inequality everywhere, but with very different magnitude across the different blocks? So this is, this is certainly a complex evolution, and I don't claim we are in the social sciences. There are different ways to interpret the data we have, and I don't claim I have the complete answer for everything. What is clear is that the rise in US inequality in recent decades is mostly due to rising inequality of labor income, although rising concentration of wealth and rising inequality of capital income is starting to become really important in the last 10 to 15 years. But if we look at the whole period since 1980, it's mostly due to rising inequality of labor income, and in particular to a collapse of the bottom 50% primary income share, as I will show you in a minute. This is certainly due to a mixture of reasons, changing supply and demand for skill, race between education and technology, globalization. Now, US economists tend to stress a lot the role of globalization, and basically the story is something like this. You have China entering the world labor market. This is putting a lot of competition on the low skill or medium skill workers in developed countries, and this is what leads to rising inequality, and there's not much we can do about it because globalization is good for other reasons. It reduces inequality between countries, and that's it. Except that globalization also happened in Germany, in Sweden, in Japan, in France, not only in the US, and you don't have at all the same level of rising inequality. So it's not going to be enough to just talk about the race between education and technology, globalization. You also need to have some institution-specific explanation. And so here you have a number of explanations which can explain why inequality increased more in the US and Europe. Very unequal access to skills in the US, and rising tuition fee, insufficient public investment in education can play a role. You have an unprecedented rise of very top managerial compensation in the US, which is very difficult to explain on the basis of education or productivity alone, or at least, you know, with the data I have, it's very difficult to relate the huge increase in top managerial compensation to any observable measure of performance and productivity. And, you know, I think in some cases it has more to do with the ability of top managers to put the right people in the right compensation committee to get the right pay increase, and probably decline in income tax progressivity, which I will talk more about tomorrow, has played a role in the increased incentives and increased aggressivity of bargaining position for top managerial compensation. And more generally, changing labor market institution, in particular in the bottom part of the labor market, in particular falling minimum wage in the US, probably played a big role as well. So I'm going to say a bit more about this now, but let me tell you that whatever you feel is the relative importance of the education channel, the corporate governance channel, the minimum wage channel, the labor market, all these explanations have something in common, which is that different institutions and policy matters and can lead different countries to different level of inequality. And basically, there are different ways to organize, you know, globalization and the way different groups can benefit or not from globalization. So in the case of the US, as I said before, the most striking evolution is really the collapse of bottom incomes. So this is quite spectacular. So this is research that I didn't have at the time of my book and that we have done recently with Emmanuel Saez and Gabriel Zucman, who are colleagues who are at Berkeley University. And we published this in a NBR working paper in December. So the difference with our previous series is that now we try to estimate the full distribution from the bottom, very bottom groups, the top groups, and not only the top. And also we try to take into account all the tax-exempt income. We also look at the pre-tax and post-tax, post-transfer distribution, which was one of the important limitations of our previous series and which had been criticized, partly for good reason. But, you know, it takes time to do it well and to collect more data. So, you know, we come back with better estimates regularly. So here you can see, basically, so this is the share of income going to the top 1%, the share of income going to the bottom 50%. So you can see that they have basically exchanged position over the period. Okay, so the top 1% has gone from 10 to 20% of total income, and the bottom 50 from 20 to 10. So I know this looks a bit simplistic as a view of the world, but you know, this is what the data is telling us. And so this is saying that, you know, the increase in the top 1% income share is not simply a matter of just, you know, a few people who get rich with no macroeconomic significance, you know, in which case nobody would care about. You know, after all, if it's just a few football players who are giving us a good show and who are making a lot of money, you know, who cares if we have a good show and it's not significant from a macroeconomic viewpoint. But here we are talking about big money. And big money means that, well, basically this is the equivalent of the decline in the share going to of income going to the bottom half of the population. So how is it that the top 1% can get a bigger income share than the bottom 50%? Well, it's quite simple. You know, it all depends on what is the average income of the top 1% as compared to the average income of the bottom 50. And, you know, you can make the computation yourself. It all depends on whether the top 1% has an average income which is 50 times higher than the bottom 50%, or more than 50, or less than 50. So to have a bigger share than the bottom 50, it means that initially their average income was less than 50 times, typically about 25 times, and at the end it's about 100 times. And indeed, this is what you have. Well, you know, it's just by the computation, but I think it's important to look at the numbers. Okay, so you can see the top 1% average income used to be 27 times the average income of the bottom 50, and now it's 81 times. And so this is why, you know, their income share, given that they are 50 times less numerous, the top 1%, they need to make more than 50 times the average income of the bottom 50 to have a bigger income share. And this is exactly what has happened. They have moved from 27 times to 81 times. Look at the numbers because they are interesting. Okay, the average income of the bottom 50% adults in the US is $16,000 per year, and which was exactly the same amount as in 1980. Okay, so basically, you've had no income growth at all over the period. which is quite spectacular. And you know, $16,000, so this is per adult. If you were to divide, including the children, it would be even less than this. So here, this is per adult. This is primary income, labor and capital income, before any tax, including before any indirect tax, payroll tax. So after tax, it can be less than this. Then you can have some transfer, and I will show you more about this in a second. But so, you know, remember, you know, I don't know if some of you, you know, I see a lot of faculty here who have been on the US job market. And, you know, as you know, in the US, when you're looking for an academic job and you are being proposed, $100,000 or $70,000, you feel that you are badly treated. You know, you feel that you are poor with $60,000 or $50,000. Well, at least many people who are going to the US academic market feel that this is terribly low wages. Well, you know, okay, half of the population has $16,000. So, you know, I think it's important to look at the numbers that are behind our Gini coefficient and inequality statistics just to have a better feel of what we are talking about. And so there is a major, dramatic collapse of the share of national income going to the bottom half of the population in the US. And this suggests that, you know, there are major change in policy. You know, you're not going to solve this problem just with ex post redistribution. You also, ex post redistribution is important, but you also have a problem of getting higher primary income for the bottom 50%. This has to do with change in the education system, in the labor market institution, in the local residential segregation. You know, there are lots of mechanisms that are involved, but in any case, you know, when you have such a dramatic change, you know, you cannot just, do ex post transfer. Ex post transfer, so this is the impact of ex post transfer. So we start from pre-tax income, which is the red curve. So the red curve is the same as the white curve here. So you have stability at $16,000. What we call here post-tax private is the post-tax, post-transfer cash income. Okay, so this is what you get after paying tax and after receiving cash transfer. But there are relatively few cash transfer in the US, although actually we've put food stamps in the cash transfer, although they are not really cash transfer. So in the end, the post-tax private income is roughly at the same level as the pre-tax income on average. Now, if you take into account the in-kind transfer, education, police force, etc., which of course are difficult to attribute to the different income groups, but we make simple assumptions to take them into account, you get a little bit higher, but you see that this is still, you know, relatively small. The Medicare, Medicaid transfer is significant. You know, this is about $5,000 per individual for the bottom 50% of the population. But, you know, at the same time, this does not really change too much the evolution over the time period. And, you know, it's not clear also, this has a lot to do, you know, $5,000 is the equivalent of 1 week of income for the top 10% of the population, or 1 day of income for the top 1%. So, in effect, this in-kind transfer is as if the bottom 50% of the population is getting 1 week of attention from a top 10% health provider, or 1 day from a top 1% health provider. So this is in-kind transfer. But does this reflect? A lot of this has also to do with rising health costs, so rising wages for health providers. So does it reflect rising welfare for the receivers, or rising welfare for the producers of health services? You know, it's complicated when you look at in-kind transfer. So this is the picture. So to me, you know, the main conclusion is that we need to worry about mechanisms that can increase primary income. So the evolution of the minimum wage is clearly important here. So here I compare the evolution of the minimum wage in France and the US. So this is all expressed in dollars and euros of 2013, taking a 1.2 exchange rate, which is more or less the purchasing power parity. So you can see that the minimum wage used to be a lot lower in France and is now higher in France. So in France, some people might argue it's too high. I think it is more an issue of the level of payroll tax on top of the minimum wage. But in any case, in the US, it's probably too low. And in fact, the level of the minimum wage, of the federal minimum wage today in the US, is less than what it was half a century ago. So in the 1960s, it was almost 11 euros per hour, and at a time where there was very little unemployment. Okay, so the reduction that you have is when it's because of inflation, you know, when you have a freeze in the nominal minimum wage and you have a little bit of inflation each year during Reagan and Bush, and you have this decline in the real value of the minimum wage. Another dimension of inequality in the US is access to education. So this is taken from work from my colleagues and friends, Emmanuel Saez and Raj Shetty, who have data on where they are able to link the income tax declaration of the parents with the social security number of the students so that they can see who is going to university as a function of your parents. And you know, as you can see, this is pretty dramatic. You know, this is almost the 45-degree line. So it's as if you know you have, well, not quite. You know, if your parents are very poor, you still have a 20% chance to go to college. And if your parents are very rich, you only have a 95% chance to go to college. Okay, so this is not a 45-degree line. You don't go from 0 to 100, but you go from 20 to 95. And of course, the people at the top, they don't go to the same college as the people at the bottom. So here, we don't even take this into account. So, you know, I think this is an example where you have a huge gap between the official discourse about meritocracy, mobility, etc., and the actual facts. So I think it's important. You know, the elites always have a lot of imagination to justify inequality, and they talk about equal opportunity, mobility, etc. And they very often claim that inequality is in the interest of everybody, in the common interest. And you know, I think we should always be a bit skeptical about this claim. You know, I think these kind of claims, sometimes they are true, but sometimes they are not true, and it's important to confront them with data. So that's why I think it's important we have more transparency, not only about the measurement of income and wealth inequality in itself, but also about access to public services, to education, to health, and in order to measure this thing properly. You know, I don't have the exact same graph for the UK, but you know, I make comparison with France in my book, where it, you know, it's a little bit less extreme. But let's be clear that no country, you know, has found the perfect way to confront this. So it's particularly extreme in the US, but you know, I'm not trying to say that this is we just have to copy what's done in a particular country. Gender inequality is also very large. So when we talk about the top 1%, we are mostly talking about males. You know, even in the US today, 85% of the top 1% are actually men rather than women. So this is another decomposition by gender that we didn't have in our previous series, which we now have in the new World Wealth and Income Database that's available online. It is actually the same, almost the same numbers if you look at France. So, you know, if you continue the trend between 1994 and 2014, we should be at 50% by 2102 for the top access to the top 1%, and by the middle of the 22nd century for the top 0.1%. So this suggests that, you know, the current trend toward gender equality is not getting us very far, or at least it's not getting us very far very fast. And there's a strong case, I believe, you know, in more voluntary policy of, in some case, you know, trying to force an acceleration of the path toward gender equality. Okay, let me move now to the second point I want to make, which is about the return, what I call the return of a patrimonial or wealth-based society. So far, I have talked a lot about income inequality, in particular labor income inequality. Now I want to talk about wealth. So of course, inequality of wealth is partly the consequence of inequality of labor income, because wealth is partly comes from saving out of labor income. So everything I have said about the role of labor market, institution, minimum wage, education, this is also going to matter for wealth inequality. But in addition, there are other mechanisms that matter for wealth inequality. In particular, inheritance is important, so financial markets and returns on different size of portfolio is important. So you have a whole set of other mechanisms that play a role. So what I document in my research is the rise of aggregate wealth-to-income ratio, which can be partly accounted for by the slowdown of economic growth, the aging of population, so that if you keep saving in an economy that has a relatively limited underlying growth, you tend to accumulate more wealth relative to income, which is not necessarily bad in itself. You know, if everybody had an equal share in a gigantic pension fund or in the real estate stock of the economy, you know, there's nothing bad in itself of having high wealth to income ratio, except that in practice it tends to come with large concentration of property, and this, you know, I point out the key role of the legal and political system and various forms of policies that can democratize access to wealth. Let me go through a couple of graphs very quickly. So this is the long run evolution of the capital income ratio in Europe, so Germany, France, UK. So what does it mean, 500% or 600%? It means that the aggregate value of wealth is between 5 and 6 years of national income. So right now, like in the UK, national income per adult will be, say, around 35,000 euros. And you can make the computation in pounds. And so 6 years of this will be around 200,000. Okay, so this doesn't mean that everybody owns 200,000 and has an income of 35. There is a lot of inequality around this average. But before we look at the distribution, it's actually useful to know how the aggregate value of wealth is changing. So you can see that, you know, there's been a huge drop following World War I and World War II, partly because of destruction, but this is actually not the main reason. In particular, there was limited destruction on UK soil, obviously. So most of the explanation has actually to do with the fact that there was very limited saving and investment between 1914 and 1945, because most of the private saving was actually used to pay for the war, which was itself used to destroy the rest of the capital stock, which is a bit stupid, of course, but, you know, this is of Europe over this period. And at the end of the period, you have a lot of inflation, which in effect reduced this public debt to zero, so that it's as if the private saving had not been invested at all and had completely disappeared. So this plays a very important role in the case of Britain, but also in France and Germany. If you do the complete decomposition in France and Germany, you have about one third of the fall that's due to destruction, one third to lack of investment, the fact that most of the private saving went to finance the war, and one third also to change in the legal system, which reduced in effect the market value of capital at the end of the period, like rent control reduced the market value of housing, or more financial regulation or limitation of shareholder rights limit stock market value of corporation, which is not necessarily bad, of course. You know, the market and the social value of capital are two different things. So here we are looking at the market value. In recent decades, you have partly reaccumulation of capital, partly growth slowdown at the end of the period, aging of the population, and also an increase in housing values, which have been quite spectacular. So you see that, so in the long run, you know, we have much more longer run theory, in particular for the UK, where you see that in the long run, agricultural land, which was a big part of the capital stock in the 18th century, does not exist anymore. Well, it's still there, but it's not worth much, just like the share of agriculture in GDP. But housing now is much more important, and the total value of what you can own in the country is back to a comparable level. You have a similar evolution in France, except that it takes a bit more time for agriculture to disappear, and also the net foreign wealth is a bit less large at the beginning of the 20th century in France, about 1 year of national income, whereas in Britain it's almost 2 years of national income, which reflects also the bigger colonial empire of Britain and more generally bigger foreign investment of Britain. So all this foreign wealth disappeared entirely between 1910 and 1950, partly again to pay for the war. Then you have the decolonization process at the end. Well, you know, I cannot enter through all the details, but, you know, this is a very lively story. This is not just a steady process. If we look at more countries, so here you have the top 8 developed economies in the world. You can see that, generally speaking, you have a rise of private wealth to national income ratio. So all countries were between 2 and 3.5 years of private wealth, of national income in private wealth in 1970, and now all are between 4 and 7. So that's important to have in mind, because, you know, sometimes in economic textbook, you read that, you know, the wealth to income ratio or capital to output ratio, which is the same at the world level, I mean at the national level you can have foreign wealth, positive or negative foreign wealth, which is changing a little bit the ratio, but you know, overall at the aggregate global level, capital output and wealth income ratio have to be the same. Sometimes you read in textbooks that these ratios are supposed to be constant, are supposed to be stationary. So, you know, be careful with economic textbook. You know, sometimes in economic textbook, you know, when we don't have much data about something, we just assume it's a constant. And, you know, of course, if you have only one data point, everything is a constant. But in fact, there's no reason. You know, even in our simplest economic models, you know, one sector model of capital accumulation with capital labor substitution, standard neoclassical production function, any ratio can be a constant. You know, it all depends on how much you save and invest as compared to how fast you grow in terms of productivity growth and population growth. There's absolutely no reason why it should be a constant. You know, if you save twice as much, well, in equilibrium, your capital income ratio will be twice as large. Now, if you move away from the one sector model, it is even more true. You know, if you go to multi-sector model with change in the relative price of assets, for instance, the relative price of housing vis-a-vis consumption price, you have even more reason to have very different wealth income ratio. If you have bargaining power, monopoly power, so that again the relative price of assets can vary if owners of capital have benefit from more power or have a more favorable legal system. You know, once you complicate the model, the basic model, you have even more reasons to have different possible wealth income ratio, and this is exactly what's happening. Now, if we look, okay, here if I put Spain in the picture, you can see that the Spanish housing bubble in the case of Spain was even more spectacular than the Japanese one in 1990. So in itself, you know, let me say again, having a higher wealth to income ratio does not necessarily mean more inequality. You know, it could be that you have very equal distribution of property. So in itself, this is not bad to have higher wealth income ratio, but it creates new issues for regulation. In particular, it means that if you make a mistake on the price of assets, a mistake on the price of your real estate, you know, when you had a ratio of 200 or 300%, it was not so bad. But when you have a ratio of 600 or 700% of national income, if you make a 10% mistake on the price of your real estate, this can have huge consequences for the real economy. So, okay, so this makes financial regulation and regulation of the capital accumulation process more generally even more important. This is more recent work we have done with Li Yang and Gabriel Zucman. In the case of China, of course, the very big increase in the wealth to income ratio involves even other mechanisms which have to do with privatization. Okay, so you start from a system where public property was very important in China, and at the end of the period, you have a wealth income ratio which is similar to what we have in the West. Now, if we look at the share of public wealth in national wealth, so national wealth is the sum of public and private, and if you look at the share of public wealth in the total, this is what you get. So you can see that China used to have 70% of public wealth and now has 30%, and it has actually stabilized around 30%, and even maybe it has increased a little bit since the crisis. Whereas if you look at US, Britain, Japan, we have actually a negative public share at the end of the period, which means what? Which means that public debt is a bit higher than the public assets. So even if you share all the, even if you sell all the public buildings, the public schools, the public Cambridge University, everything, I'm not saying you should do that, but let's assume you do that. Well, that's not enough to reimburse the public debt. So the public debt is bigger. This means that in effect, private owners, they own the entire public capital stock through public debt, and they even own a bit more. So it means they have ownership rights on the future payment by future taxpayers. Okay? So this is something that puts limitation on what government can do, of course, because it means you have to repay a lot of interest payment before you can do anything. Whereas in China, this is the opposite. You get interest payment and dividend payment from your public assets, which means that you can finance more without having as much tax revenue. Now, you know, I'm not saying this is the ideal system. I just want to say that, you know, this 30% share In fact, in the 1950s, 60s, 70s, what we sometimes call the mixed economy period in Europe, we had share of public wealth that were comparable, well, maybe 20-25% in Britain or Germany or France in the 50s, 60s, 70s. So the level in China today is not, it's a bit higher, but it's not completely uncomparable to this. So again, collecting data on the structure of private and public wealth can allow us to better understand this process. So you have exceptions like Norway, where in fact the share of public wealth has gone through the opposite evolution of China, but of course it's a much smaller economy, and this is due to the accumulation of sovereign funds through oil revenue. Okay, so in some countries with large sovereign funds, you can have in effect a share of public wealth that is going up, but this is not so significant at the world level. Now, let me conclude by talking about wealth inequality now, because so far I have talked to you mostly about aggregate wealth without looking at the distribution, which is a big part of the issue. So here my claim is that, you know, there are strong forces going on that could push toward increased wealth concentration, but, you know, of course there are other forces that could also put in other directions, so, you know, this is not a deterministic process. Let me talk about some of the forces leading to higher wealth concentration. First, let me say that there is not enough transparency about wealth, and, you know, we don't know enough about wealth. So sometimes we have to use this kind of data coming from Forbes billionaire rankings, which frankly I am a bit ashamed to show you this, because this is, you know, it's not clear at all how they do their rankings, and, you know, maybe this is overestimating the trend, maybe this is underestimating the trend, you know, to be honest, we don't know that much. But in any case, let's do with what we have. I think this is still better than the household survey data based on self-reported information, where you have nobody above £1 million, basically, which, you know, is a bit crazy, because we know you have people at high wealth level. So let's try to see what we learn from there. Usually when people use a billionaire ranking, they just say, okay, you have more and more billionaires every year, this is very sad, or this is very good, depending on your persuasion, and that's it. But of course, in a growing world economy, it is not too surprising that you have more and more billionaires. So here what I do is a bit more sophisticated. I take a fixed fraction of the world population, which itself is rising, and I look at how the average wealth of these very top groups has been increasing. So I start in 1987, just because this is when Forbes started to publish their world rankings of billionaires. What you find is that average wealth at the top has been rising at 6-7% per year, whereas average wealth per adult in the world has been rising at about 2%, 2.1, and average income at 1.4. So world GDP has actually been increasing at 3.3, and this is about what we have in 2017, 3.3 or 3.4. But remember that population growth is not over yet. I mean, it's supposed to go to zero by the middle of the 21st century, but in the past 25 years, particularly because of aging, in fact, population growth has taken more than half of the world GDP growth. So per adult income growth has been only 1.4, even though you have China and you have all the emerging countries in there. Average wealth has increased a bit more. This is because of the increase in the wealth to income ratio that I have shown you before. But at the top, you have an increase at 6-7% per year, which of course, you know, if this was to continue forever, this would mean that the share of world wealth going to billionaire will converge toward 100% in the long run, which, I think everybody would agree would be excessive. And you know, I'm not trying to pretend that we are going to go to 100%. I'm sure we will stop before that. But you know, this can go quite fast, and I think it's sufficiently spectacular to try to understand why this is happening. Now, part of the reason over this time period could be that, in fact, you have a lot. Let me first make clear that the explanation cannot be just, okay, you have people who make innovation, who become rich, because you should also have people who go down. So the process of mobility in itself cannot explain why the average wealth in this top group is rising 3 times faster than the size of the world economy. If you have some people go up, you should have some people go down, and if we were close to a steady state of the world distribution of wealth, these two effects should more or less compensate each other, so that the average wealth at this level should more or less grow in line with the size of the economy. So here you need more than this. Privatization over this period can be important. So, you know, you have lots of people at the top of the wealth distribution, like, you know, Russian oligarchs or, you know, Carlos Slim in Mexico, who owns the entire telecom sector in Mexico. You know, it's not that they invented the oil fields in Russia or the telecom sector. It's just that they became owners of what used to be public assets, sometimes at very cheap prices. So the good news is that there is not much left to privatize, so at least, you know, this mechanism should stop. Now, there can be other effects which have to do with the fact that the return to wealth tend to be larger for large wealth portfolio. So let me now show you data on returns to university endowments. So I'm showing this to you, you know, not to depress you, because, you know, I know that the, you know, the large US university endowments, you know, are much larger than the endowments in Cambridge. Although, you know, I think Pontus, you told me that the endowment of Corpus Christi was doing very well with very high return. Well, you told me about a 6 to 7% return. So, you know, this is the bottom of the distribution here. But this is because you have only 100 million pounds instead of 10 billion. So in fact, the main finding, so this is what's striking here, so is that basically the higher your endowment, the higher your return, and the impact is quite big. So let me make clear, these are returns, this is net of inflation, you know, so these are real returns, and this is after deducting all management costs. Okay, so this is really the pure return to capital. And as you can see, you know, US universities are doing quite well. The only reason I'm showing this data is that at least these people release data. So we have good data on their portfolio, what they do, which we don't have for the Forbes list people. So this is why I turn to this data. At least we can see. And what we can see is that, okay, they are all doing well. You know, on average, they are doing 8.2% over this period. The higher you go, the better the return. So clearly, you know, US universities, they are not investing in US treasury bonds. You know, so they are investing in complicated financial derivatives, in you know, futures and commodities, all sorts of assets that require a lot of expertise. But because they have very large endowments, so if you take Harvard, Yale, Princeton, you know, today they have endowments of 30 billion, 40 billion, 50 billion, whereas in 1990 it used to be 3 or 4. And this is not because their former students have given them a lot of money. You know, just to compare, the annual gift that were made to these top three universities are the equivalent of 0.5% of their endowment each year, you know, as compared to this return of 10%. So this is completely not significant. So, you know, sometimes this can be useful to get your children admitted to these schools, but in terms of increasing your endowment, this is really not what matters. What matters is this very high return, which you get partly through this investment in very sophisticated financial assets. Now, if, you know, take the case of Harvard, you know, their total management costs are only are of the order of 0.5% per year, actually 0.3, 0.4% per year, but now because they have an endowment of 30 billion to 40 billion dollars, you know, this is increasing each year, 0.3% is already 100 million. So if you can spend 100 million each year in management cost, you know, you can pay a good group of financial advisors, well, this is actually the equivalent of your entire endowment for Corpus Christi, so of course, you're not going to be able to spend this each year because otherwise there's no capital to invest at the end of the year. So, and this is what Harvard is spending each year. Now, if this allows them to get a return of 10 rather than 6 or 7, of course, it's worth spending 0.3% each year. Okay. Now, in the case of Harvard, maybe it's not a problem because they are doing useful things with the money, etc. Although you would also do useful things with the money. So. But, you know, if this happens at the world level for the distribution of wealth between individuals, you can see that we have a problem. Okay? So, to be honest, as I said before, we don't really know very well, you know, what's happening at the top of the wealth distribution. So, what we have done recently is to try to collect more data. In particular for the US with Gabriel Zucman and Emmanuel Saez, and also for France with Jonathan Goupil and Bertrand Garbenty. If we look at the entire distribution of wealth, and I'm going to conclude there, you learn a number of things. First, you can see that financial assets are very important at the top of the distribution. Housing is very important in the middle. So you know the middle class is the kingdom of housing. This is where housing matters. So people who have between 100, 200, 400,000 euros, housing is what matters. And people who are very poor mostly have deposits, you know, the deposits on their account. Okay? So financial assets are extremely important at the top. And this is also what generates a very high top capital incomes in the top of the income distribution. So if you look at the income composition by income level, you get the very high capital income, in particular through financial interest and dividend at the top of the distribution. Now, if we try to compute the long-run level of wealth inequality, and this is where I will stop, you know, then, you know, when you look at the long-run evolution, if you look at the top 1% wealth share, you have a long-run decline, and you have an increase in the recent period. We are still much lower than the level at the time of Downton Abbey and, you know, at the beginning of the 20th century. If we try to understand, you know, in the long run, so this is for France, you can see what I told you before, the top 10% share is always a lot larger for wealth than for income, which is something that you cannot easily explain if you have, for instance, a life cycle model of wealth accumulation or a precautionary saving model of wealth accumulation. You will not generate so much concentration at the top. So you need inheritance, you need dynamic random shocks model. Let me describe, okay, this is the only equation in this presentation. You know, I have nothing against equations, but you know, I think we should use them with more parsimony than what we do sometimes in this profession. I think it's good to have simple equations to explain a lot of facts, and the problem sometimes is that we tend to do the opposite in economics. We have very complicated equations to explain very little fact, or sometimes no fact at all, which is a bit of a problem. But, you know, very simple equation for accumulation of wealth. Wealth at period T plus 1 for group P, which could be the top 10%. This is wealth at period T plus saving out of income plus a possible capital gain. If you look at the steady state, so just look at the equation in the middle. This is the share of wealth going to the top 10% in the long run as a function of the share of labor income going to the top 10%. The bottom line is that you have huge amplification mechanism if you have higher rate of return at the top and higher saving rate at the top. So if everybody has the same saving rate, so SP, if P is the top 10% group, SP will be the average saving rate for the top 10% and S the aggregate saving rate. If SP equals S and RP equals R, it means that everybody has the same saving rate, everybody has the same rate of return, then wealth inequality is the same as labor income inequality. This is just a translation later in life of labor income inequality. But if RP is bigger than R and SP is higher than S, you can see that you have huge amplification mechanism. And the bottom line, the short conclusion, is that small changes in parameters can have huge long-run consequences. So this is a simple simulation using this model in the case of France. Basically, we have two simulations for the future. We don't know which one is right. All we are saying is that this really depends, you know, if you have a bigger inequality in rate of return or bigger inequality in saving rate in this case, and this is apparently what has been happening a little bit since the 1980s, is that maybe because of the growth slowdown, the bottom income groups have reduced their saving rate a lot. And so it's very different, of course, if you, for a given gap in saving rate between the top and the bottom, if the bottom almost don't save at all, well, in the long run, it means that you converge to extreme concentration of wealth. You know, I'm not saying, look, nobody knows what's going to happen, but this is a very unstable process. Okay, you can have very different, so you have a steady state in this model. Okay, this is not going to go to infinite inequality, but the steady state can be very different, you know, depending on the parameters you put in this formula. So, conclusion. Lecture one, you know, so what we have covered today are the first 2 points, you know, the long run dynamics of income inequality, the long run evolution of wealth and the possible return of a patrimonial wealth society. This is what we will cover tomorrow morning, inequality in emerging countries, which will in particular involve issues of racial discrimination, which I have not talked about today, and rising inequality and the changing structure of political conflict. So thanks a lot for your attention. Thank you.